Well, hey, good morning, Quad City. If you want to go ahead and grab a seat, we're going to jump in and get started. Hey, we are so glad that you guys are here. So glad you've joined us, man. We are believing that today is going to be a great day. We're going to spend some time at the church worshiping together through song, through sharing communion together, and then lastly, hearing the Word of God preached. Man, if you're new here, thanks so much for checking us out today. We're just glad you joined us. Man, we know that some of the stuff may be new to you. You may be a little unsure. That's okay. Feel free to jump in whenever and however you feel comfortable this morning. If you're new, we'd also love the opportunity just to connect with you. And the easiest way to do that, you can just pull your phone out and you can text the word Quad City to 94,000. It's Quad City to 94,000. You're going to get a form back when you fill that out. One of our pastors this week is going to reach out to you, answer any questions you may have, and give you some great next steps to plug in with us. Again, so glad that all of you guys are here. Let's go ahead and stand up and let's sing together.
Sing this out.
I was buried.
And I was buried beneath my shame. And who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. And I was breathing but not alive, and all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you.
He called us. Come on, let's sing this out together.
You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day, you called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Come on, let's sing out about his mercy.
Saved my soul, and now your freedom is all that I know. The old me knew, Jesus, when I met you, you called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day, you called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Rescue, our God made a way with his great power. Come on, let's sing this out together.
I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, my chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now you're that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name, I ran out that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You
God has made a way. Let's continue to sing and worship Him this morning. Come on, let's sing out together, Man of Sorrows.
Man of Sorrows, Lamb of God, by His own my salvation, where you love.
that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Give Him praise. Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty. Praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
Amen. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. Well, as we transition to a time of communion and our ushers begin to pass the trays that have our elements in them, the bread and the juice, I just want to take a few minutes and reflect on the words of the psalmist in Psalm 77 to help our hearts and minds as we remember just what Christ has done for us on the cross. He says in there, "But then I recall all that you've done, O Lord. I remember your wonderful deeds from long ago. They are constantly in my thoughts. I cannot stop thinking about your mighty works." Communion is a great time for us to recall, to remember what the Lord has done. And it helps to do this on a grand level, but also on an individual level as well. On a grand level, that for all of creation, because of Jesus and His life, death, His resurrection, and His enthronement, the powers of sin and evil no longer have the last word. And then for us in our individual lives, we too must, like the psalmist, develop a practice of remembering. And we can remember by asking questions like, "What has the Lord done for you? How has He set you free? What has God rescued you from? In what ways has God lavished His goodness upon you? How has the Spirit of God guided you and led you and empowered you to live the life that God has called you to live?" And we too must join in with the psalmist and make this something we think about constantly. Because when we do that, it will cultivate in us a deeper and truer worship for our God who has done a mighty work. So in these next few minutes, as you reflect and as you spend just a couple of minutes, as you draw near to God, my hope and prayer is that God begins to fill your heart and mind with the things that He's done for you, that He is doing currently right now in you, and what He will do for us in the future. All of which is most gloriously seen through Jesus' work on the cross. Let me pray for us. Father, we're grateful. We're grateful for Jesus. We're grateful that, God, You have acted long ago in history, and that Your plan brought Your Son, and that it has rescued the entire world. God, we're grateful for the ways that's played out in our own lives. For the things that You do for us and in us, we are just incredibly grateful. And Jesus, we love You and we thank You. In Your name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand as we continue to sing together?
Stop, no. We make.
that is who you are, and you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Lord, we know that to be true, and so we boldly proclaim that over our lives, Lord, that you are in control, that you are working miracles, that you are making a way. Lord, we are here for you today. Speak in a powerful way to us. We love you, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat.
Church family, and those of you in Prescott Valley, man, we have the opportunity and blessing to start off before our sermon with not one but two baptisms this morning. So yeah, definitely really excited. Yes, right. So the first one here, this is John. John came this morning and said, hey man, I'm tired of not living God's way, and I want to submit and be obedient to him and do what God calls me to do and take this step of faith and be baptized. And so, man, that's what we want to see all of our people do. And so, John, with that, I just want to have you take the confession. So just simply repeat after me.
I believe
that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I accept him.
I accept him.
To be my Lord and Savior.
To be my Lord and Savior.
Well, amen. It's with that confession, it's an absolute honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins and the gift of that Spirit. Everybody, this is Dina. She came about a couple months ago, and we just started talking about what does it look like to be obedient. She had questions about what baptism was, and she knew it was important. And so, man, it's been so cool getting to know her and hear conversation and seeing what God is already doing in her life, how he's already working. And she wanted to have her sister-in-law be here with her to support her. And so, again, it's just an honor to get to do this. And so I'm just going to have you. Yeah, we can clap. Yeah, that's all right here. Yeah, for sure. Definitely want to encourage. So I'm just going to have you simply just repeat after me, all right? I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I accept him.
I accept him.
To be my Lord and Savior.
To be my Lord and Savior.
It is with that confession that it is an honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins and the gift of that Spirit.
Amen. That is a good way to celebrate our Sunday together. So glad you're here. My name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors here. We are honored that you have chosen to start your week off by worshiping with us here at Quad City Christian Church. I want to welcome all of those who are online from whenever and wherever you are. So grateful to have you with us today. And I also want to welcome in those in Prescott Valley. So grateful to have you with us. If you're a newcomer with us, whether here or in Prescott Valley, our pastors would love to connect with you here in Prescott. You can go out into the lobby off to the left. We have a place we call Pastor's Point. I'll be hanging out there after the service. We'd welcome you to come by and introduce yourself out in Prescott Valley. Head to Connection Center. Our pastors will be hanging out there. Come by and say hi. Well, today we are continuing a series we kicked off last week where we're calling it, that we're calling Off the Flannelgraph. Now, I just need to ask, how many of you never had the opportunity as a kid to experience the glories of a flannelgraph? How many of you? Anybody? Oh, see, I feel like I just need to hug all of you. You just need, just so missing out. I was told that our Catholic brothers and sisters didn't get flannelgraph. Like, it was not in the Catholic Church. So I just feel for you. My heart breaks. Now, for those of you who don't know what a flannelgraph is, if you grew up in church in the 70s or 80s, there was a high probability that in a stuffy church basement somewhere, there's a little old lady who had a board that looked like this with a box full of amazing felt scenery and figurines, and she'd pull out a children's Bible and she'd read this story and put the little people on there, and she had really docile tones, and it was so great and comforting and loving, and God came down and there was a storm and everybody died. It was great, right? And so you hear these stories, right, from the flannelgraph, right? And so this is the way it went. And so we learned these stories. So for many of us who had this opportunity at some point, there are many stories in the Bible that when we hear the stories, this is what we think about. Now, there's some good that comes from that. One of the good things is that somebody cared enough, loved you enough to actually share the story. Like, they wanted God's word to be in you. And so that was a good thing. But the problem was that for many of us, when we hear these flannelgraph stories, what happened is those biblical texts just became for us children's stories. Like, that's what they became. They were just like these children's stories. And it's kind of like, have you ever watched like the TV version of Shawshank Redemption or Braveheart? And then you actually watch the real movie. And then you watch the real movie and you're like, oh, that's awful. I didn't know that was in there. How could that happen? I don't remember that part, right? Because you got the sanitized TV version. Sure, you get the gist of the story, but you miss out on the more difficult parts of the story. And that's what happens for many of us with these stories. Is we get the sanitized flannelgraph version of the story, and it becomes a children's story. But they're not kids' stories. They're the Word of God for us. And so, what we're doing in this series is we're trying to take these stories off of the flannelgraph and actually see what the Word of God has to teach us. Because they're not kids' stories. They have meaning and purpose and value for us as adults in 2022. And so, we want to dig into the Word of God and let it speak to us. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn them to Joshua chapter 5. That's where we're going to begin today. So we're going to look at the story of the Israelites going into the promised land and the fall of Jericho. So Joshua and the fall of Jericho. For you millennials in the room who enjoyed your VeggieTales, this is the story of Josh and the big wall. Okay? Now, before we get to the story of the fall of Jericho, we need to set the scene. And so to do that, we actually have to kind of back up like 400 years. So God comes to a guy named Abraham and says, I choose you. I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to bless the world through you. Come follow me. So Abraham follows God. And God leads him out of the land that he was grew up in and takes him to the land of the Canaanites, which we know is modern day Israel. And God says to Abraham, this is going to be your land. Your offspring are going to live here. And Abraham's like, oh, it's great. One caveat. Before your offspring come into this land, they're going to spend 400 years as slaves in a land not their own. So, you may remember the rest of the story. You got Abraham, then Isaac, and then Jacob, and then a guy named Joseph. So Joseph had 12 brothers. His brothers didn't like him very much, and they sold him into slavery. And so they ship him off. And he ends up in Egypt. Well, God uses him there, tells him, hey, there's going to be a huge famine in the land. You better prepare. So Joseph does a smart thing and hoards a bunch of food. And the famine comes and everybody's hungry except the Egyptians. They have food because of Joseph. Well, Joseph's brothers, who are living in a land far away, here Egypt has food, and so they come down and they get reacquainted with Joseph, and Joseph invites his whole family to come to Egypt where he takes care of them. So about 70 of them all move to Egypt, and everything is good, and they're flourishing because Joseph is a high-powered man in the government taking care of everybody. It was a great part of the story. They all die. The Pharaoh, who loved Joseph, he dies. Those 70 people who first came to Egypt, they kept multiplying, generation after generation. Another Pharaoh comes in and says, oh my goodness, there's all of these foreigners living in our land. If somebody invades us, they'll probably side with the invaders and try to overthrow us. We have to subdue these foreigners. And they made all of Joseph's family slaves in Egypt. And God kept multiplying them. And over 400 years that they just stayed as slaves, multiplying in the land of Egypt. Until finally, after 400 years, God comes to the people, specifically in Moses, and says, it's time to get my people out of here. And he shows up in the burning bush through the 10 plagues, gets the people out of Egypt to take them back to the land that God had promised Abraham 400 years before. God didn't take them directly to the promised land. They went through the Red Sea. You remember that whole scene. And he spent about 2 years wandering them through the wilderness, giving them the Ten Commandments, giving them the law, getting them prepared to be their own nation. And they end up on the Jordan River about to cross into the promised land. And that's when Shemua, Shaphat, Egal, Palti, Gadil, Gadi, Amiel, Sether, Nabi and Guil show up. Do you remember these guys, right? No? There were two other guys with them, Joshua and Caleb. There were 12 spies that Moses said, hey, go into the land and scope it out. Let's see what's there. And these 12 spies go into the land that God had promised Abraham for his offspring and says, they go in and they look and they come back out and say, it is amazing. This land is amazing. It is flowing with milk and honey. There is fruit and harvest. It is like bountiful. It is a glorious land. But these 10 say, but we can't go in there. Like there are giants in the land. They have these huge fortified cities, mighty fighting men. We're like grasshoppers in their eyes. They will stomp us to pieces. We can't do this. Only two, Joshua and Caleb, say, God gave us this land. It's ours. We need to go. I always find it interesting. There are 12 of these. 10 of them you don't remember. 10 of them, the faithless ones, are a footnote in the story of the faithful ones. You've never heard anybody naming their kid after a Gadiel, but you know lots of people named after the two faithful ones. But the people believed the 10 and not the 2. So they said, we can't do this. We should have just gone back to Egypt. And God says, okay, if you don't want the land I've given you, then you don't get it. All of you, back out to the desert you go. Nobody over the age of 20 is going to get to go into the promised land, save Joshua and Caleb. So for 38 more years, they march around the desert while everybody who walked out of Egypt dies in the desert. So fast forward, 38 years later, Moses himself dies in the desert before he gets to go into the promised land, and Joshua is given the mantle of leadership. Joshua leads the people into the promised land. God does another miracle. The Jordan River was at flood stage, separating the Israelites from the promised land, and God stops the river, and all of these people, scholars estimate somewhere between 600,000 and 1 million people, have now come out of those 70 for 400 years, and now they're marching into the promised land. God stopped the river so that they could cross over into the promised land on dry land. What God did for the Israelites in the Red Sea, for their parents and grandparents, God did for this generation, crossing the Jordan into the promised land. And they set up camp on the other side of the Jordan River, right across from the mightiest city in the promised land, the city called Jericho. So, If I were going to start the story and invite you to jump into the story of the fall of Jericho, most people would start in Joshua chapter 6. However, I think the good part of the story, maybe the most important part of the story actually happens at the end of chapter 5. So, if you got your Bibles, let's go. Joshua chapter 5, starting in verse 13. It says, "Now when Joshua was near Jericho, he looked up, saw a man standing in front of him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went up to him and asked, 'Are you for us or for our enemies?'" So you get the scene. Joshua, maybe doing some praying, maybe strategizing, but he's out walking, seems to be by himself. He's near the town of Jericho. He sees it. It's right there. And as he's kind of walking, got his head down, all of a sudden he looks up. And he's surprised. That's what this phrase here means. He looks up. He's startled. And he sees right there in front of him a man with a drawn sword. You'd be surprised too. I mean, he's about to go into battle, and now he's got this guy in front of him with a sword drawn. Joshua's a military man, so he looks at the guy and says, "Okay, here's a question for you. Are you for us or are you for our enemies?" That's the question. Are you for us or are you for our enemies? We're about to go into battle tomorrow. I just need to know, they've got an army, we've got an army. Whose side are you fighting for? Are you for us or are you against us? And the man's response is telling. He says, "Neither." What? "I ain't for you and I ain't for them. I'm not here for you and I'm not here for them. Neither. As commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come." Then Joshua fell face down to the ground in reverence. Joshua hits his face. Why did he do that? Because he recognizes in this moment he is no longer in charge. Like every encounter that Joshua has, people bow down to him. I mean, he took the mantle of leadership from Moses himself. Everybody looks up to Joshua, but not now. Joshua's got his face in the dirt. He is looking up. He takes the posture of submission. And whenever I read this story, I can't help but think that maybe Joshua made the same mistake that we sometimes make. That Joshua had been invited onto this mission that God had. That God was bringing his people back to the promised land. The land that he had promised to Abraham. And Joshua was invited to be a part of this thing that God was doing with his people. But somewhere along the way, maybe it is that Joshua got it confused and thought it was his mission. And so his first question is, are you for me? Are you for us? Or are you for them? And this angel who's standing here must have laughed and thought, no, you got this all wrong. I'm not for you. I'm not for them. I am the representative of God here. I am the commander of the army of the Lord here. I don't join you. You join me. I don't join you. You join me. And Joshua hits his face. The real question for Joshua is from the angel, are you for us or are you for them? It was Joshua who needed to pick a side, not the other way around. And then again, I just think about how many times in my life I've done the exact same thing. I think about how often I try to get God to join me instead of me trying to join God. Like, God, I've got this great plan. Will you bless it? Like, God, I've got this great vision. Will you endorse it? Like, God, I'm going after this really great guy. Will you help me land him? Like, God, I'm moving in this direction with my finances. Can you fund it? Like, God, this is what I'm doing with my life. Are you for me or are you against me? And I think God's saying, No, you got the wrong question here. I'm not the one who needs to pick a side. You do. I mean, how many times do we pray for God to bless this or bless that? In essence, what we're doing in those moments is we're saying to God, are you going to be for this? Will you join us in what we're trying to do here? And again, I think God laughs and says, I'm not here to join you. I've called you to join me. And maybe you're thinking, well, that's just all kind of semantics, right? Whether I join God or God joins me, and we're still on the same team, right? No, there's a huge difference. And the huge difference between whether or not I join God or God joins me, the huge difference is who's in command? Who's in charge? Who calls the shots? And Joshua in this moment knows exactly who calls the shots. And it ain't him. Which is why he's face down in the dirt. And listen to his response. Joshua fell face down to the ground in reverence, and he asked him, what message does my Lord have for his servant? Here's a question for us this morning. I want you to try to think about your prayers for the last month, 6 months, a year, 2 years, 10 years, however far back you want to go. Think about your prayers for the last however long you want to go. Put a percentage to it. Here's the question. How much or how many or how long, how often are your prayers about trying to get God to do what you want as opposed to how much, how often, how long, or how many of your prayers are about trying to understand what God wants you to do? So how many of your prayers are about trying to get God to do what you want versus how much of your prayer time is spent trying to understand what God wants you to do? What's the ratio? In my very anecdotal personal experience, my guess would be the vast majority of our prayers is about trying to get God to move in our direction. To get God to do what I want. To get God to be for me. Now, don't misunderstand it. We can pray and should pray and ask God for things. That's biblical. We should be doing that. But more important than trying to get God to move in my direction, more important than that is about positioning my heart to be bent in a posture that it's always trying to move in God's direction. That's way more important. It's moving my heart to a place of surrender to Him, not trying to get Him to surrender to me. Like, it's why Jesus prayed a prayer that we should pray. He modeled for us this attitude when He looks at His Father and says, not my will, but yours be done. It was a posture of Jesus of surrender. Here's what I want, but more than what I want what you want. So don't do my will. Do your will. Jesus is teaching us that we are responsible to join God in what He's doing, not the other way around. And so Joshua hits his face, surrenders to the Lord, and says, what message does my Lord have for His servant? You are in charge. You call the shots. You are the master. I am the servant. You are the king. I am the peon. You are the Batman. I am the Robin. What do you want me to do? And the commander of the Lord's army replied, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy. And Joshua did so. Just as God had done with Moses in the burning bush some 40 years before, God says to Joshua in this moment, the ground you're standing on is holy. So take off your sandals. Which again is mind-boggling to me. Because in our culture as people, like, whenever there's something holy or sacred or special, we try to put as many layers between that in common people as we can. Like, I remember going to Abraham Lincoln's house in Springfield, Illinois, doing the tour of his house. And you walk through, and there's a special carpet that you have to walk on. You're not allowed to get off of this carpet. Because you stand on that hardwood, Abraham Lincoln stood on that, you're not allowed to stand on that. You stay on the carpet. And you walk through the house, and every doorway has a barricade. And you can look into the room, but you can't go in. Because Abraham Lincoln sat on that chair, you can't sit on that chair. Like, it's special, and you're not. So stay behind the barricade. Like, you go to a museum and every famous painting is behind glass and they've got guards and security. And you don't, because lest you touch it, you mere mortal, this is special, you're not, stay away. Like, you go and you see the crown jewels and they've got lasers and glass and bars. And we keep people away from things that are special. You're not allowed to, in national parks, they put up railings to keep you from desecrating the sacred spaces. Yet, God says to Joshua, this ground is holy. So take off your shoes. I want you to feel this with your own flesh. I'm inviting you to come skin to skin with me in this moment. This is holy. And I want you to be a part of this. That's our God. He invites us into the holy. He doesn't push him away. So Joshua takes off his sandals. And he shares the battle plan with Joshua. Now, the gates of Jericho were securely barred because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men." Pause. What does Joshua see that is any different than what he saw yesterday? What does he see that is any different than what he saw an hour ago? What is it that Joshua actually sees? What he sees is the same thing the spies saw 40 years before. They saw a very scary, very big, very fortified city filled with mighty fighting men. That's what he saw. I mean, he's standing there looking at this city. That's what he sees. And then he turns around and he looks at his army, which are made up of the children and grandchildren of a bunch of slaves who've never picked up a sword in their life. That's what he sees. And what did he see? He probably saw a city that looks something like this. Over the last 100 years, there have been 3 major excavations of the city of Jericho. They know exactly where it is. They've dug it all up. They've done 3 of these. This is what they've found. It's a city about 9 acres in size. The circumference of it, if you were to march around it, it's about a mile to go all the way around this thing. What you can't see from this angle, let me give you a cross cut. What they found as they've done these excavations, this is the walls of Jericho. So there's this foundation wall at the very bottom. That foundation wall is somewhere between 12 and 15 feet high. On top of that foundation wall is a mud brick wall, which is 6 foot thick and about 20 to 26 feet tall. There's then this berm that goes up, and then there's another mud brick wall. Again, it is 6 foot thick, 20 to 26 feet tall. You can't really see it because it's a little grainy, but if you look down here in the bottom right-hand corner, these are the soldiers, to get a little bit of the scale. From the bottom of that foundation wall to the top of this mud brick wall is 46 feet. 46 feet. That's what Joshua sees. But look at what God says. Now the gates of Jericho were securely barred. No one went out. No one came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands along with its king and fighting men." See? No. I don't see. I see a giant fortified city. That's what I see. God speaks as if it's already done. God's speaking in the past tense. See, I have delivered Jericho. I've delivered them into your hands. See? I don't need to know who needs to hear this today. But you need to stop focusing on what you see, and you need to start focusing on what God says. Like some of you, your focus is on what you see, and you're neglecting what God has said. He's made promises to you that are as good as true because he has said it. Nothing you have ever seen is more true than what God has said. The Lord said to Joshua, see, I've delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Have 7 priests carry trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. On the 7th day, march around the city 7 times with the priests blowing the trumpets. When you hear the sound, a long blast on the trumpets, have the whole army give a loud shout, and then the wall of the city will collapse, and the army will go up, everyone, straight in. So here's what I want you to do, Joshua. Take all your men, march them around the city, every day for 6 days, 1 time. And then on the 7th day, march them around 7 times, blow the trumpet, give a shout, and the whole thing's going to fall down. Okay, imagine you're in the army, and Joshua comes to you and says, okay, guys, here's what we're going to do. Tomorrow, we're going to battle. Take your swords, but you're not going to use them. But you're going to need some hiking shoes. And they march around the city. And then they go back to camp. Like, that's it. That's the whole thing. The next day, they get up, and they march around the city, and they go back to camp. And march around the city, and go back to camp. Day 7, they march around 7 times. And they blow the horns, blow the shofar, blow the trumpets. That's what they do. And when the trumpet sounded, the army shouted. It sounded the trumpet when the men gave a loud shout, the wall collapsed, so everyone charged straight in, and they took the city. Meaning the breach was all the walls fell straight down. And again, you can go read about it yourself. The excavations of Jericho reveal that what happened was that mud brick wall on the top collapsed, slid down that embankment, hit that other mud brick wall, which collapsed. And both of those walls came and essentially filled all of the space, created a ramp up that foundation wall. So when it says that everyone went up straight in, it created a ramp all the way around the entire city. And the Israelites won the victory. It's an amazing story. But the question is, so what? What's the point? Great story. What's it got to do for us? Why would God give them the victory in this way? Like, they're going to fight 100 more battles in the promised land. And they're going to use their swords, and they're going to go to battle. And it's all the strategery of every other warfare of the day. That's how they're going to win these. Why not do that here? Why the miraculous collapsing of the walls? Why the marching and the ark and the horn blowing to get the victory? Why? Because God wanted the people of Israel to understand, and he wanted all of the people in the promised land who are going to hear about this battle, he wanted them to understand this was God's victory. This was the work of Almighty God. This battle was not won because Joshua was a great leader. This battle was not won because they had great military strategy. This battle wasn't won because they had a highly trained army. This victory did not get accomplished because they had an artillery full of advanced weaponry. None of that stuff was true. God wanted to leave no doubt. This victory came from him. In other words, this is God saying, I didn't join Joshua, Joshua joined me. And I think God wants us to have that same posture. which means for us that we got to change our tone with God. Instead of saying, God, I've got this great plan, will you bless it? We say, God, I know you have a great plan, help me understand it. Instead of saying, God, I've got this great vision, will you endorse it? We say, God, I know you are the giver of great visions, reveal it to me. Instead of saying, God, I'm after this great guy, will you help me? We say, God, I am content with whatever relational status you have for me. God, I've got these directions I'm going in my finances, can you fund it? No. We say, God, you've given me how I should direct my finances. Help me obey it. God, this is what I'm going to do with my life. Are you for me or are you against me? No. We say, God, I give you my life. Do with it what you will. It is an act of surrender. Because I don't join him. I'm sorry. I don't ask him to join me. I join him. We fall on our face like Joshua. And we say, what message does my Lord have for his servant? So here's the question I want to leave you with today. In what areas are you still trying to get God to join you instead of surrendering yourself and joining him? In what areas are you still calling the shots and then calling out, hoping God will bless it? Where have you been going your own way and doing your own thing and simply trying to drag along God for the ride? We want to take a posture as a church and as a people of hope and handed surrender. God, I'm not asking you to join me. I want to join you in whatever you're doing. Not my will, but yours be done. Father, I pray today that you would reveal to us where it is that we're still trying to maintain control, to do our own thing and get your stamp on it. And instead today, I pray that we would open up our hands and hand it all to you. And that we would be willing as Joshua to do the thing that sounds ridiculous. It's so foolish. But because you say it, we'll do it. Because what you say is more important than what we see. So we want to surrender ourselves to you. We give all that we have. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Well, amen, church. Hey, a couple really quick announcements before you guys are dismissed this morning. First one is, for those of you who are a part of Quad City Students, whether students or kids, our student ministry is moving their weekly midweek programming from Monday evenings to Wednesday evenings starting August the 10th. So that's anybody from 7th to 12th grade. They meet up here in the student building from 6:30 to 8:30 every Wednesday night. So you definitely want to make sure you come and check that out starting August the 10th. Second thing is we have a group that's kicking off that we call Financial Peace University. So this is for any of you who are maybe struggling with finances or just need some tools to really help you take those next steps. Maybe you are trying to be obedient and just going, God, what should I do? This is a great next step. So the classes begin the 7th, which is a Sunday. They'll be here at Prescott campus during our 11 a.m. service right here in conference room. So you can go to our website and sign up there through underneath our groups page. Next, for those of you who are women, we have a brown bag lunch event coming up. So this is something where all the ladies of Quad City are invited to come and bring a brown bag lunch. They're going to meet at the courthouse on the southeast corner by the post office, across from the post office. So basically going to study the word together, spend some time in a small group hanging out. So the next one is actually this Friday at 10 a.m. So you're going to want to bring a brown bag lunch. You need to bring a chair. You need to bring a Bible and a journal if you're a journaler, all right? And you can hang out with some ladies. You don't have to sign up. You just show up. So hopefully if you are free and available, you guys can do that. Lastly, our prayer team will be available down front. If you are maybe looking to take some next steps, or, man, you just need someone to pray with you, maybe there's some things going on in your life and you just want somebody to listen, man, our team would be honored to do that. They'll be up front at the conclusion of our service. Hey, hope you guys have a great rest of your day. See you back here next week. You're dismissed.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away our sin, who takes away our sin. The Holy Lamb of God makes us alive again, makes us alive again.